Dear workshop participant, I'd like to thank you for your attention during these difficult times. I am Joni Lappalainen from Optenni Ltd, and I'd like to discuss with you about comparison of analytical and numerical beamforming optimization of phased arrays. This workshop is organized as a part of the IMS2020 Industrial Workshop Series. Let's begin with a brief overview of the workshop. Our main goal today is to explain and explore the benefits and, more importantly, limitations in analytical beamforming techniques. Where do they excel? Where do they fail? And most importantly, why do they fail? Furthermore, we'll be building upon these solutions and going beyond them by utilizing numerical techniques. This results in robust and predictable behavior of real-world arrays. At Optenni Ltd, we believe that designing arrays is a multidisciplinary problem. The designer needs to consider beam, circuit, and system level behavior when designing the product. An assessment for a real-world array could, for instance, be the following. What is the obtainable side lobe level such that the active element impedance remains under minus 10 dB and the total system efficiency is at least 90%? To answer this question and furthermore assess, analyze and optimize arrays, we'll be using our product, Optenni Lab RF Design Automation Platform, with its novel array module. We'll be starting this workshop with a discussion about the theory behind analytical beamforming techniques. This is required to understand where and how they should be used. We'll then continue with the limitations arising from the simplifications required in the making of the analytical formulations. We'll also be introducing numerical beamforming techniques and, most importantly, what kind of prerequisites exist to properly utilize them. Also, we'll naturally be showcasing the obtainable solutions, even for the cases where the analytical techniques fail. And in the end, naturally, there'll be a summary of the findings of today's workshop. Let's begin this discussion by considering what is a good beam. It of course varies from application to application, but generic beam level targets are typically related to the direction, intensity, and width of the main beam. And this, of course, is required to establish communication to a particular customer, for instance, or in radar applications to detect something in a given direction. There's naturally criterion related to the side lobe level, which is basically the distance or difference between the main beam intensity and the highest maxima outside the main beam, also including any grating lobes if present. These are typically especially important in radar and detecting applications, as they not only decrease typically the system efficiency, but also the signal-to-noise ratio. Last but not least, you may also want to create some nulls in your radiation pattern. So if we look at the pattern at hand, we have a quite nice side lobe ripple, which is typical to arrays, but we seem to be missing a couple of lobes there. And the reason for that is that we have actually enforced with beam optimization a null in those directions. Nulls are typically considered to be sort of anti-jamming features, but they can also be relevant in modern 5G networks. Because if you have a certain signal-to-noise ratio you need to, for instance, establish communication, and you already have all the signal you can, and the ratio still is not good enough, you can indeed try to reduce the noise by synthesizing some nulls to the directions of the noise. However, to be able to optimize any beams must be naturally be able to calculate them first. So let's consider the following. How to obtain the total radiation of a system consisting of n radiators? Well, a classical way to approach this problem is to utilize the so-called array factor. The array factor not only approximates but accurately describes the total pattern of a system that consists of identical isotropic radiators that do not affect one another. What this basically means is that the current distributions need to be identical on each of the elements up to a complex constant. So they can vary in amplitude and phase, but the current distribution itself needs to be identical. The array factor is widely used because it is an extremely efficient and compact representation of a radiating system. Furthermore, for a well-isolated and relatively large array, the approximations made are actually quite correct ones. Before we get further, I'd like to mention that the array factor assessment can easily be expanded to non-isotropic radiators by implementing the pattern multiplication. This means that the total pattern of an array can be obtained in an ideal case by multiplying the array and element patterns. For example, let's consider the following visible region of an array factor. Highly symmetric in both of the half spaces, which is not typically that ideal for all applications. However, should we apply a directive element that barely radiates to the other direction, in this case we have the embedded element pattern of a patch antenna, the resulting pattern is, as stated, obtained by multiplication of those. So, albeit there's maxima in the visible region of the array factor towards 270 degrees, as there is practically zero of the element pattern, will the resulting total pattern be zero as well? And these lobes as well are scaled correspondingly as the element pattern is diminishing to those directions. How to then obtain the element pattern to be used as a basis for the array factor analysis? Theoretically, you could utilize the radiation properties of an element in free space. However, I'd not recommend this, because in the real world scenario, the element is interacting with its neighboring area. So even if it would be quasi-ideally isolated from the surrounding elements, will they be at least acting as reflectors and hence affecting the impedance and radiation patterns of your array? So Typically, when we are simulating single elements, we see rather round and nice radiation patterns. But the embedded patterns of elements typically fluctuate due to constructive and destructive interference of the reflections from the surrounding or the environment. Furthermore, on antennas that contain substrates, as the constellation of the array changes, so does typically the substrate field intensity. What this means is that for a real array, the radiation efficiency tends to be a function of the element locations as well. Other option to obtain the embedded element pattern is to utilize periodic boundary conditions. You basically make the array infinite to certain directions. There are major pros to this methodology, one of most important of which is the fact that it results in an extremely small simulation domain. You only need to mesh a single element. The con, however, is that, as mentioned, you now have an infinite array, which induces some effects. First of all, if you are designing an element which will utilize a ground plane, will the ground plane become infinite as well, hence destroying any information about back radiation for the real product? Furthermore, because the array is infinite, will all of the elements have identical electromagnetic environments? So the edge elements, etc., all behave similarly, which is not typically the case for a real array. Albeit, in such cases, designers sometimes implement so-called padding cells, elements that are not fed, but are there just to work as reflectors for the corner elements as well, so that they behave similarly to the other elements. Furthermore, the accuracy of this approximation diminishes should you implement spatial tapering, meaning that you have a non-regular grid used in your array. Now that we are familiar with the basics, let's continue to a brief demonstration in which we utilize array factor and different array factor based optimization strategies. So I'll be using Optenni Lab throughout this presentation, but for now we'll be doing some things that you most likely have already done with some MATLAB scripts, so let's not delve too deep into the program yet. So I have basically loaded some S parameters not required for the array factor, as well as radiation patterns for a simple patch array element. So I'll be navigating to arrays, array factor, and first we need to define a geometry for the system. Let's add a new one. And for now, let's consider a 1D grid, a one-dimensional one. My elements are towards Z direction, and I'll be going for half a wavelength at 28 gigahertz, which is approximately 5.35 millimeters, if I recall correctly. And let's say I want to have 10 elements. Okay, now I have a grid. I'll choose OK. I'll navigate to arrays, array factor, and then canonical excitations. So let's begin with something simple. Let's use uniform excitation, which means that we basically have the same amplitude for all of the elements, and then we apply a progressive phase shift. I have simulated more than one element already, which is relevant later on, but for now I'll just choose the pattern of an embedded antenna, a center element. And OK. There we now have a 2D plot in which we have the theta and phi and the resulting realized gain at the given frequency. Let's look at 28 gigahertz, and we can right click on this plot and tune excitation parameters to steer the beam. However, as we are only steering in one plane, it might be beneficial to look only at the polar plot in this case. I'll be choosing constant phi 180 as my 2D cut. So vertical phi 180. There we have it. And axis scaling, let's lock it down from minus 10 to 20. And now we have quite nice result. Let's maybe increase the scaling a bit. So the amount of side lobes is related to the amount of components, for instance, as to be expected. And as I tune the progressive phase shift, after a certain direction, a greater side lobe appears. And that indeed is not the side lobe, but the grating lobe of the array. Furthermore, as you can see, the side lobe level is varying as we go further away from the broadside. And the reason is that, albeit the array factor is quite regular, our element pattern for the patch is cutting away or diminishing away from the broadside. Okay. Good. Let's try something else. I'll go to erase, array factor, canonical excitations, and use binomial coefficients. In theory, binomial coefficients obtained, for instance, from the Pascal's triangle result in no side lobes. So let's see if this indeed is the case. Let's once more look at the polar cut, constant phi 180. Maybe scale the axis down a bit. A bit more dynamic range, let's say minus 35. And there we have it. So indeed, beyond the main beam, there are no maximas if the back radiation is not counted. And here, the difference between a side lobe and a grating lobe is nicely present. So after a certain direction of steering, the grating lobe appears and there is nothing to be done with the amplitude tapering regime, at least. We can, at any stage if we'd like, right click on a solution and choose show excitation. And as we can see, the Pascal's triangle indeed is in use, resulting in quite heavy amplitude tapering of the elements. Last but not least, let's go to arrays, array factor, canonical excitations, and use Dolf-Chebyshev equal ripple polynomials. And this time change the frequency as well. So once more, polar cut, vertical, phi 180, change the axis, let's say 30 again, and there we have it. And now if we tune this excitation, we actually have more parameters available. So not only can we steer the beam, but we can also change the amplitude tapering, hence affecting the beam width slightly, but also the side lobe level. Basically, the Dolph Chebyshev is a nice way to find a good trade-off between amplitude tapering and side lobe level. To compare the pros and cons of each scheme, we can right-click on a solution and select copy to a user plot. So let's do that for all three of our schemes. And progressive phase shift as well. And to make the plot more readable, let's name them. So we had Dolph, we had binomial, and we had progressive phase shift, quote unquote, default. And if we color them, we can quite easily see that the progressive phase shift actually had the highest maxima. The Dolph came second with a bit wider main beam, and last was the binomial. But should we compare the side lobe levels, the binomial wins the Dolph Chebyshev even easily, especially if the back lobe is not compared. My point being that there are pros and cons to each optimization scheme, and none of them is one suits all. For now, we have not considered nulls yet, so let's do that next. Let's go to arrays, array factor, optimize beams, and we'll be utilizing the optimization engine of Optenni. So we give a frequency, which pattern of a port we want to use, and then we can give targets to main lobes, side lobes, nulls, etc. So let's now try to generate a main lobe towards this direction. And furthermore, let's try to create a deep null towards theta 90 degrees. We can optimize only magnitudes or phases or both simultaneously. And naturally, you can either use automatic generation of the initial coefficient for the optimizer, or should you have a civilized guess existing, you can enforce it through the initial value menu. Let's click OK and see what happens. So this optimization will take a couple of seconds because our software is now calculating through the 180 times 360 radiation pattern points, because I have 1 degree sampling in both theta and phi. And furthermore, there are 20 optimization variables because there are 10 ports, and for each you have magnitude and phase. However, the optimization still took only 12 seconds, which isn't too bad considering the solution domain. Let's take a polar cut, vertical, 180 degrees once more, and change the axis scaling a bit. let's say minus 40. So indeed it seems that we have a main lobe towards the wanted direction and also a significantly smaller minima towards theta 90 degrees. Also, if we combine this solution to the comparison plot, let's rename it and add the default colors. This is now theta 60 main beam, theta 90 null. Okay. So this seems to have quite nice main beam intensity, actually exactly the same as the progressive phase shift towards 60 degrees. The side lobe level is somewhat on the same level, the main difference being that this solution has a truly deep radiation towards theta 90 degrees. It might be easier to compare these if instead I have a look at the Cartesian cut. So let's copy these solutions as well. Right click, let's create a new user plot and take the previous progressive phase shift one, Cartesian, and copy it there as well. And let's edit this once more. This is now the theta main beam, theta 90, 60, null theta 90 versus progressive theta 60. Default colors. And let's change the axis scaling to truly appreciate the null. So as we can see, with practically no cost to the main beam towards the wanted direction, we have now significantly lower intensity towards theta 90 degrees. Hence, will there be a jamming signal coming from that direction or any noise, we would have significantly higher signal to noise ratio for the system. At the beginning of the workshop, I stated that the results obtained by using the array factor are actually approximate. And the reason for that, of course, is that the array factor itself is obtained by utilizing different approximations. So let's now study the accuracy of solutions found with array factor towards something called full array data, which I'll elaborate shortly. So I'll go to arrays, array factor, and enter array geometry. And this time I'll define a grid towards the negative y direction. The reason for this is that I have an EM model for such an array, and this allows us to easily compare the solutions. I'll choose OK, OK, and let's generate arrays, array factor, canonical excitation, and for instance, let's use Dolph Chebuchet and port 5 a center element once more. Let's right-click and tune the excitation parameter. And let's change the axis scaling a bit. Look at the center frequency. And let's find something of interest. For instance, a grating lobe. Okay. Furthermore, let's try to optimize a null. I'll go to arrays, array factor, optimize beams. Let's look at 28 GHz, main lobe towards a certain direction, a null towards another. Please note that this time the broadside is theta 90, phi 180, and we are steering at a constant theta, sweeping phi. And let's optimize. Let's first look if we succeeded. So 28 GHz and Cartesian cut. Theta 90 is great this time. And we indeed have radiation towards the wanted direction, as well as a rather steep null towards phi 170. But let's now compare this to the full array resolution. So I'll right-click on this solution and choose Show Excitation. I'll copy it, choose OK, and navigate to Arrays, Full Array, and the excitation. I'll paste the excitation in and choose OK. So now we have something we call a full array solution. So what do we mean at Optenni with a full array solution? So if we pay attention, we not only have a single radiation pattern inside Optenni Lab, but actually we have the pairport radiation patterns for the full 10 element array. Furthermore, we have the S parameters, including the coupling terms for the full array. This allows us to recombine, including the coupling effects, the total radiation pattern of the array for a given excitation vector. This approach agrees with the solutions provided by EM simulators and is also applicable in the presence of matching networks. So to elaborate, our place in the design and optimization of an array is downstream from an EM simulator, meaning that we ourselves do not do the full wave simulation. Instead, you do the unit cell or embedded element to begin with assessment in an EM simulator. You then send, depending on the design stage, either the radiation pattern of the embedded antenna or the full N-port S-parameter matrix and 3D radiating patterns of all ports to Optenni Lab. Then, inside Optenni Lab, you can optimize your array further by running automated and highly efficient optimization studies on your system. If need be, you can then re-optimize your EM geometry based on the feedback you obtained from Optenni Lab. Last but not least, as we are about to show, the results based on the simplifications, for instance by array factor, are not truly optimal, and hence it will be beneficial to optimize with the full information about the radiation and coupling of the system. So now that we can trust that we have at our hands a more accurate solution, let's begin with the simpler solution. So let's have a look at the array factor, canonical excitation, right click, show excitation, copy, OK. Arrays, full array, and the excitation, and paste it there, and choose OK. Then let's take a Cartesian cut, right click, copy, sorry, of course we need to navigate to the relevant frequency, right click, copy, and create a new user plot. Then let's have a look at the canonical excitation, also at 28 GHz, Cartesian cut, and right click, copy to user plot. And there we have it. Let's modify the plot a bit to be able to study the solutions. And change the axis scaling a bit. So there are a few things we should notice. First of all, the main beam is basically spot on throughout its shape. Furthermore, the existence of the grating lobe is really nicely approximated by the array factor. In between, the nulls of the side lobes are around there, but the side lobe level generally doesn't agree completely. There seems to be some 4 dB discrepancy in the result. But point being that the generic shape of the full array is quite nicely actually approximated by the array factor in this case. Let's then study the more complex excitation, the forming of the null. So we take the array factor beam optimization solution, right click, copy to a user plot, create a new one, and we take the full array first fixed excitation, right click, and copy to same user plot. And let's rename this once more. This time the blue one is unfortunately array factor, and the green one is the full array. And once more, as you can see, the main lobe and the first side lobes agree really nicely. Otherwise, the side lobe level is somewhat correct, but we do have one discrepancy that is not great. The null does not exist for the full array. The difference in between the level is in the range of more than 50 dB. And when considering, for instance, a jamming scenario, what is basically spatial filtering of signals, 50 dB is a huge difference. Question is then, of course, that is the full array capable of forming a null to this direction? So let's study that out. Let's go to arrays, full array, and optimize beams. Now we need to re-enter the targets, which were, give me a second. So there, right click, modify settings. So it was main lobe 90 220, 90, 170. So main lobe 90, 220 and null 90, 170. And we need to define a band. So Optenni Lab indeed is capable of broadband optimization as well. In some scenario, it is not enough to have the beam to be proper at the point frequency, but there most likely is a finite width to the beam, and hence you can ensure that the beam is as intended throughout the signal. This time the optimization took a bit longer than a minute. The reason for that is that this time we have individual patterns for each of the ports. So instead of 180 times 360 points and then a summation of those, we actually have 10 times that amount of data. Furthermore, we also have the S-parameter matrix to worry about, and we hence need to calculate the voltages and currents basically to be able to combine the radiation patterns. Let's select the center frequency, 28 GHz, and choose a Cartesian cut. Looks promising, but let's copy this to the use plot. And then we have the full array reoptimized. Changing the line type a bit. So indeed it seems that the full array is able to create deep nulls as well. But unfortunately, the excitation vector to do that is different from the one assumed by the array factor approximation. It is, however, quite intuitive that a sharp null is also a rather sensitive one. So what would have happened if we had instead optimized for a broader null? Let's go to Erase, Array Factor, Optimize Beams, Port 5. Let's give some additional weight to the main beam to ensure that it doesn't deteriorate too much. And let's go for not as steep a null, but one that has a bit more radius to it. We should be good to go. This time the optimization took some 25 seconds because there were more points for the optimizer to consider when searching for the null. 28 GHz and Cartesian cut. And indeed, this time we do have a broader null. And the main beam is still somewhat okay. So let's copy this solution to a new user plot. And also show excitation, copy, erase, full array, and the excitation, paste, okay. Cartesian cut, 28 GHz, and copy this to the same user plot. And right click to modify the plot a bit. And it seems that this time the deterioration of the null is not as bad, but still exists. But overall, the shape agrees better this time regarding the location of the null. As we have all of the element-wise radiation patterns here, let's have a glance at them. There's port 1, port 2, port 3, port 4, port 5, etc. So it indeed seems that all of these element patterns are more or less unique, especially the corner element. So, what kind of error would have been made if a different unit element would have been considered? So, let's redo the array factor, canonical excitation, assessment, but this time let's use the corner element. And let's once more steer the beam at 28 GHz to some direction. Apply some tapering. Right click, show excitation, copy excitation, OK. And arrays, full array, enter excitation. Let's paste it in, choose OK. And now let's take the Cartesian cut at 28. Copy this to the user plot and do so for this solution as well. Let's rename these solutions. So we have the full array solution and the array factor solution. Let's maybe apply some scaling. As we can see, this time there is significantly more discrepancy between the full array and array factor solutions. Point being that when deciding the representative element for your system, you truly should be careful to get the most out of your array factor approximations. And now I'd like to discuss a bit about active element impedance. So our array is nicely matched around 27 GHz inherently, and the coupling at those frequencies is around minus 21 dB, which is, to my understanding, considered good isolation for a generic array. However, a minus 20 dB still means that some power entered into a port will also flow to the other ports as well, which will then turn the inherent impedance into something else known as the active element impedance. Let's see how this behaves real time by navigating to arrays, full array, and canonical excitations. And let's study for now Dolph Chebuchet tapering. So instead of 28 GHz, let's take the frequency at which the antenna was tuned, 27 GHz. And for broadside excitation, the antenna seems to be somewhat 50 ohms. And please note that this is now the active reflection coefficient. As I right-click on the plot and tune the excitation parameters, for the full array information, we not only calculate the radiation pattern for each excitation, but also the active element impedance. As you most likely know, there are impedances that amplifiers can and cannot drive when seeing them as load impedances. So, albeit you might be able to synthesize a beam that is quote-unquote good enough in the EM sense, might the resulting impedance be beyond drivable for the PA designer, meaning that the array cannot be realized. This is especially the case in designs that utilize amplitude tapering, because even small levels of coupling will result in high active reflected powers when there is dynamic range in the power levels of the system. Hence, when doing the beamforming optimization, the designer should be careful to not to introduce too sharp amplitude tapering levels to ensure that the active element impedances remain good. When doing beamforming optimization with Optenni Lab, you have the possibility to add an active reflection coefficient target to the system, ensuring that the optimizer doesn't go for impedances that will not result in working products. Optenni Lab also provides means to control the active element impedances by impedance manipulation utilizing matching networks. Should we go to multiport, multi-antenna matching, we could indeed try to find a matching network that, instead of optimizing for the 50 ohm environment, it would do its best to control the active element impedance for a set of excitation vectors. Furthermore, there's the possibility to optimize simultaneously the excitation vectors as well as the matching networks, resulting in a truly optimal system. However, unfortunately, that is beyond the scope of today's demonstration, and is instead something we'd be happy to elaborate if you contact us through info@optenni.com. To conclude, when utilized properly, array factor can be a powerful tool assisting designers in choosing the element type, amount and constellation when designing antenna arrays. However, this is only the case when the designer remembers the limitations arising from the approximations required to build the array factor. Even for a relatively well-isolated array, it was shown to be beneficial to not only assess, but to also re-optimize the excitations of the array to ensure that the product is operating as intended in the real world as well. Last but not least, we'd like to remind that the designer should always be careful of the active element impedances when designing antenna arrays. Thank you for your attention. Please visit our virtual booth as well as our website and do contact us at info@optenni.com should you have any questions or comments regarding our presentation. Thank you.